Okay, I think we can start now.
Espera. Ja està. M'escoltes, Guillem?
Sí, perfecte.
Però no se'm veu, no?
No.
Vale, perquè se m'ha quinxat el portàtil. Bueno, és igual. Comencem. Ok. Posa garantia completa? Va. Okay, so welcome everyone. Good night and thank you for attending. We are Daniel Marín and Guillem Bonilla, and with collaboration with the UPC, el Centre de Recerca d'Enginyeria Biomèdica, és el CREP, i el undergroup B2S, Bioinformatics and Biomedical Signals, we are the responsibles for presenting you this hackathon challenge. It is called File Processing and Machine Learning for Audio Classification with Python. Okay, so what is this challenge about? The objective of this challenge is to use audio samples, which will probably be mostly COVID, and other data to make a model that suggests whether one can or not have COVID. We will supply you with enough sample data, which will consist on COVID and other breathing sounds, which will be already labeled with or without COVID and its corresponding metadata. But you are more than welcome to actually search for more data and do your own methods. The thing is that at the end, you have to think outside the box. The final objective is to use machine learning and signal processing techniques. We merely provide you with some tools to begin working with. But, well, just as in June track, I will say that the first step of this challenge will be to make a model to differentiate audio samples that are to say that they are cough or they are not. You know, that will be the first step. And then try to differentiate if the cough is or is not COVID. Okay, sí, que esta sea positiva. So, there are multiple reasons why we thought this was an interesting idea. Due to the virus's high infection ratio, there is an actual over demand for methods of diagnosis, such as PCRs. And multiple papers have already found that cough and other lung-related sounds can carry information about their health state. So in this challenge, we want to explore the idea to make a model that, well, it will be not by no means a diagnostic method because you cannot diagnose if you are not a doctor, but, well, you know, it can actually help us to know whether it is or not possible that one has the virus. So the funny thing is that the only thing that we will need from the patient is some information, some data that can be quickly acquired with any mobile phone. That is, I know, their weight, their age, their location maybe. You want to do a sprout map, you know, to see where there are more, where the device is more active, and audio samples, which can be sent with, with your mobile phone as well, with las notas de audio. So that means that we will be developing a tool that, even if it is by no means as fail-proof as a PCR, it will be virtually free and globally accessible, even for less developed countries. So at the end, this challenge is about making the most out of the most simple. All right. So Guillem and I, have already started a similar project, which also includes other features and its own implementation. Our model already can recognize whether a sound is a cough or it is not, and implements that functionality to a whole system that in the end will become a tool, like we mentioned before, eventually in the near future, I hope. And as for now, it includes its own Telegram bot for acquiring that data, a database to store it in a NoSQL SQL format, Mongo server, and an API to correctly acquire the data, so it can be sent not only in the future, not only from Telegram, but from other sources. So regarding the model, we want you to go the extra step and make a model that can recognize COVID, you know, besides cough. Right now, it is our project. Right now, it is only gathering data data, but in the future, the objective is to use that data to make a powerful model that is like a big version of what you will try to do this weekend, this hackathon.
Okay, well, first of all, hi everyone, I'm Guillaume. And now we will look through four or five Python scripts, okay? Of course, you can use, for this challenge, you can use Python, R, or your favorite programming languages, okay? The scripts that I will show you can be found in the GitHub of the project that Danny was telling to you. This GitHub, it's here in this link, and you can clone the repository if you want, and also you can download the scripts if you think that it will be useful for you. But again, you are free to use or not use anything that I will show you. Okay. So, well, the first thing that I want to share with you is I want to give you a small introduction of about the structure of the data of our repository, because in some sense it's a little bit odd. Then I will start with this import data script, which in fact it helps to see how we can work with the paths and the directories of this repository. Okay. The second script that I will show you is one called Future Extraction. We have used in our project a really useful library of Python, which is called Py Audio Analysis. And well, basically, it's really useful because it can help to extract a ton of different interesting features from raw audio in a tabular way. So in this way, from one audio, raw audio, we can get like a ton of variables. And I don't know if you, like me, are more used to work with tabular data, but in fact, it's really useful, okay? The third script that I will show you, it's about the creation and the training of our models. In this point, I would like to add that, as Danny has told you, we have already trained a model that is capable to distinguish an audio that contains or not a cough. Because, I mean, before you want to predict if a cough is from a patient that suffers COVID, you have to first filter the audio that if it's not a cough, it's not worth it to analyze it. So in our project, we have took two different approximations to analyze the audio data. The first one is that we have trained a support vector machine using this library called P Audio Analysis and these features extracted with this library. And the second approximation that we have used, that it's also really interesting, and maybe if you want, you can use it too, is that all audio, in fact, in our computers are stored in the time domain, but it's easily we can easily transform it with an algorithm called the fast Fourier transform, and we can transform it to the frequency domain. And in this domain, we can extract like several interesting things. Like, for example, we can plot and visualize the spectrogram of the audio. In this way, we have a graphical representation and we can work not with an audio, but with an image. And as we transform this audio to an image, we can use a convolutional neural network that I think that all of you are already familiar with. And in fact, in our project, we have used a pre-trained convolutional neural network that is called YamNet from the TensorFlow Hub, which can be found here, okay? And I will show you how to import it because it's really simple. And in fact, its predictions are really accurate. Then I will show you the fourth script, which is the evaluation of our classification models. Okay, we will just talk a little bit about the ROC curves of our models, the optimal threshold, and all this stuff. And also, I want to show you that we have also fitted a stacking classifier. So basically, we have built a meta model that takes as an input the predictions of the both previous models, and just predict a new prediction that hopefully it's better than the individual ones. Okay. So well, basically now I would like to show you how the data of our challenge is structured. Okay. So basically, if you download the data from the Synology link that we have shared with you in the Discord, you will find this, okay? There are two text files. One is the README that contains basically all the things that I will tell you now. And then the listens one, where we give credits to a project where we have extracted a lot of our data. Of course, you are free to see these files, okay? Then the repository is divided in two main parts. The first one is one called unlabeled audio. Basically, here we only have like audios that are cough and audios that are not cough. So we don't have any kind of label that adds further information about the COVID status of the patient. And basically, these files that are here are the ones that we have used for train our models in our project and also for evaluate our models. As you can see here we have like 500 audios of cough, and in the other one we have like 431 audios of no cough. But in fact, these no cough audios contains sniffings and other human sounds, which are quite similar to coughs. And also the second part, and the most important and most interesting one of the repository, is this one, the labeled audio. Here we have three main folders, which are like self-explanatory, I think. In this one, for example, in the neck one, we have all the data from all those participants who are in fact have a negative COVID, basically. And in the positive, we have data from patients that are suffering from COVID. And in the last one, we have like positive COVID, but asymptomatic patients, okay? So if we go inside, for example, the positive folder, we will see like a really strange folders here. This combination, this string that is like combination of numbers and letters basically defines a unique ID for each patient. So each one of these folders is a patient. And if you go inside, you can see the data audio of each one of the patients. As you can see, we have two samples of a cough, which is like really good because for each patient we have two coughs. And also we have like other types of audios, like for example, breathing ones, an exercise of counting, etc. And we wanted to keep these audios because we think that maybe if you use it as an input of your predictive models, maybe it could lead to improve a little bit the predictability of your models. So you feel free to use it if you want it, okay? And just the last thing about the structure of the data, in the main the repository of the data, we have also an Excel file called metadata. And here, if you go inside, basically we can see for each one of the patients, we have the unique ID and also like interesting metadata like age, gender, and also Boolean variables that inform us about symptomatology and all this stuff. For example, we can know if a particular participant is a smoker, which maybe if you want, again, you can use it in your predictive models, and maybe it could lead to improve a little bit your predictions. So, well, basically now I will go through the first script in Python that I wanted to show you. The first one will be about how to deal a little bit with the structure of the data. All the scripts that I will show you are really simple and straightforward, and I'm sure that there are like faster way and more optimized ways to do things, okay? But this is how we have done things. So, well, basically, what we can do is, originally, we have this first part of the audio. We could do, for example, is to create a test set and a training set, and just move the half, for example, the half of these audios to the test set and the other half to the train set. So in this way, we could have in the same folder all the audios that we will use for train our models. So in this way, it's like really straightforward. We can just define some paths, and well, here we create in like really easy all the both train and test repositories here, as you can see here. And if you go inside, we have the cough and no cough also. And then with this for loop here, we can move the half of the cough audios to the train and the other half to the test. And this is quite useful because, as you can see here, like in a really fast way, we can move all these audios. So if we return to this folder here, we can see, okay, we go here, we can see that we have already built this division, this partition of the data. And if we go to the train, we will see that the half of the cough audio, in fact, are inside the train. Okay, so this was quite easy, but in this second part of the repository, the labeled audio, the structure of the data is more odd because, as you can see here, for each one of the patients, there is a folder and is a little bit more tricky. So what we can do, for example, is to extract all these, all the two samples of coughs from each one of the users to a unique folder. So in this way, we have a unique folder that contains all the positive coughs of our participants. And of course, in order to like keep the traceability of from which cough is from which user is the cough that we are analyzing, we could also like rename the file with the unique ID of the patient. So this is what we have done here, okay, with the labeled data. In a really simple way, we create the path, the directory, and with this for loop, like a really simple one, we can move all this stuff. And of course, if we had to do it like by our own manually, it will be like really, really, really slow. But in this way, we have created here in just a moment a folder that contains all the positive coughs of each one of the patients. Okay, so now we will work with this directory that we have already created. The second script that I wanted to show you is the one that we have used for our project. In our project, we have used quite a lot the P-Audio Analysis library. You can use it, feel free to use it, or if you don't want, you don't have to, okay? But we will show you what we have done. And basically, we only have to define the paths of the directory that we want to analyze. Okay, as you can see here, the new directory that we have created before, the train and cough and no cough, with this function of the library called directory feature extraction, we have to only like introduce the path, and it will like directly extract futures from each one of the audios. So if we execute this, I haven't executed before because it takes a while. We can see that for each one of the audios, we have extracted like 140 approximately variables in a tabular way. So this is quite useful and quite fast also. If we go here, we can see from which file we have extracted this data. And of course, if we go here, we can see like the arrays containing all the data, okay? We can do this not only for the cough audios, but also for the audios that doesn't contain cough in order to see if there is a difference between the both classes. So basically here we define few levels and the file names. And here, what I want to show you is we have created a data frame with pandas and we can import it to an Excel file. And let me show you what we have created in just a moment. Just remember that we are analyzing this. And in the train test, we can see the Excel that we have created. Okay, and as you can see here, for each one of these rows are an audio. And as you can see here, we have a tons of interesting features. Some of them are really correlated between them. So you have to like work more if you want to apply this. You have to maybe do some kind of PCA or something like that. But still, it's quite useful because we can see here the label of the audio that we have extracted all these features and also the name of the file. Okay, so we can do exactly the same, but for the for the directory we created in the labeled audio. We can do exactly the same, extract all this information, but for the positive cough audios, which is this one that we already created before, okay? So just let me warn you about one thing. From each patient, as I told you before, we have two different samples of coughs, but some of them, the length of the audio is like too short. So I recommend you to use the SON file library, because in this way we can really simple evaluate the duration of the WAP file. Basically by dividing the total length of the WAP file by the sample rate of itself, okay? The units of this division, it's seconds, which is the duration of the file. And well, in this way, we can just delay the audios that are too short. And why we want to do this? Because sometimes the audio that is too short leads to problems with the future extraction function of the Pi audio library. So if you want to use this approximation, I think you should like try to analyze the duration of the sounds, okay, of the audios. And as you can see here, in total, we have removed two audios due to short duration. Okay, like now that we have preprocessing all this stuff, we can also like extract the features of these audios. And well, as you can see here, of course, we can build a data frame with pandas. And also, if you want, you could do like an inner join of both tables, not only the one with less extracted features, but also the one that I showed you before, that it's called metadata, that contains all the personal information of each one of the patients. So if we do it, we will get this. Basically, the Excel that we have created, it's just inside here. And it's like really similar to the other one. Basically, we have for each one of the audios, like a tons of information that it can be like be the training data for our models. And also, as you can see here, by using the key of the unique ID of each one of the participants, we have also the personal data, the metadata of each one of the participants, okay? And this could be really useful for analyze or for discard variables. Okay, Now I want to go to a third script. Basically, okay, maybe some of you, some of the attendants to this talk are hackers that will do the challenge. So I'm aware and I know for sure that you are far more familiar and more skilled to like train models. In this script, I will show you just an example that how you can just train a model in a really simple way with scikit-learn. And this is something that we have used in our project in order to just train the models to distinguish, again, between an audio that is cough and an audio that doesn't contain a cough. So, well, basically, we can just read the Excel that we created before. And, well, as you can see here, we can just plug and check the interactions between variables. For example, in this case, in this pair plot of Seaborn, we are checking the interactions between the variable 1 and the variable 103, only like randomly selected. And as we can see here, not only in the scatter plot, but also in the density distribution plot, we can see that there is a lot of overlap between the two labels, the cough audios and the no cough audios. So in fact, it seems that for these two features, there is no hyperplane that could separate properly in a linear way the two classes. So maybe we could apply like a kernel functions to transform our data in a higher dimension. So we could do it. Of course, as I told you before, we could do like a multivariate techniques such as a principal component analysis and all this stuff. I will skip it. Okay. We can do like the partition of train tests and all this stuff of always. And okay, in this part of the script, we have used in order to make the hyperparameter tuning, we have used the grid search of scikit-learn. But of course, you feel free to use whatever you want. You can use like the random search, or you can use even the Bayesian optimization approach if you want. We have used the grid search basically, and what is doing here is to find the best combination of hyperparameters that estimates the higher accuracy in classification. Okay, we have used not only the radial and Gaussian kernel, but also the polynomial one in order to check which is better for our problem. Okay, and then with the best combination of hyperparameters, we have fit our model. Okay, yeah, this function here, it's a really simple one that like plots the decision boundaries that our model has created. I think that sometimes it's good just only to trying to infer the logic that it's behind what is the model doing in fact, but of course we cannot do it with all our features, so we have to plot this decision boundary only using like two columns. Okay, so in this fact, if we apply this function to our model, we can see that for these two first features here, we plot the purple points are the cough audios, and the green ones, the yellow ones, excuse me, are the knockoff audios. And as you can see here, this is the hyperplane that is defined and defines the decision boundary of our model. Okay, if we just plot it for other features of our data, we will see another decision boundary. But still, it's good just to infer a little bit which is the logic behind our models. Of course, we can do it the same for polynomial kernel. And we can easily save our classifier with the library joblib. and maybe we want to use it in another script. Let me say that in our project, in fact, we use we didn't train the model with scikit-learn. We train it with the same PI audio analysis library, because it has a really, really, really useful and straightforward function that is called extract features and train, where you have to just pass as an input the path that where all the audios that you want to analyze are. And in fact, it extracts the features and train the model in the same line. So it's quite useful. And of course, if you want to use it, you can train a support vector machine, car nearest neighborhoods, random forest, gradient boosting, or even the extreme random trees. And if you execute this line, it will appear here in the folder where you are executing this script, the train model. And then you can use this train model, you can import it and use it in another script. So this is really useful. And this is something that we have used it for our project. And then the final script that I want to show you is one that is a little bit modified, but it's something really similar that what we have used for evaluate the models that we have used, both the support vector machines and the YAMNet convolutional neural networks. And well, as you can see here, we import some modules from this modulos folder. And I want to show you just in a moment that in order to import the convolutional neural network that is trained for TensorFlow Hub, and it's trained with thousands of hours of YouTube videos, with only one line, you can import the whole convolutional neural network. So it's amazing. And we have used it because the predictions of these models are really accurate. And now I will show you how accurate they are. Okay. So basically here, we define the paths of the cough and no cough audios, and we do we use both the YAMNet and the support vector machines to predict these audios, okay? And we store the predictions, and then we analyze by printing the confusion matrix and checking the rock curves of the model. In fact, this function, it's really simple, and it's a good evaluation of the classification models. So in this part, I would like to add that the only drawback of using the YAMNet convolutional neural network is that the predictions it outputs are one or zeros. It's the predictions are not probabilities. And this is something that maybe it's a drawback, because it doesn't make sense to plot the rock curves. Okay, so in this case, the predictions of the YAMNet, as you can see here, we can see the confusion matrix and also the classification metrics. As you can see, the recall of the YAMNet convolutional neural network to identify, in fact, the knockoff audios is really, really, really high. And additionally, the precision to correctly identify the cough audios is also really, really high. On the other hand, the predictions of the support vector machine that we have trained with the P audio library, it's a little bit worse. Here we can see the optimal threshold and the rock curves. Okay. And of course, the metrics of classifications are moderate to high. So it could be better. It could be better. So we thought that we could maybe just fit a stacking classifier of both predictions. So build a meta model to try to maybe improve the predictability of our models. Okay, so basically we do that, and we fit here. You can find how we fit it. A stacking model, and as you can see here, wow, the rock curves and the area under the curve, it's really high. Here there is a strange behavior, and is due to the fact that the YAMNet predictions are one or zeros, not probabilities. So it's quite odd in this case, but still all the classification metrics are really high. And in fact, we saved this model and we applied in our own project. So basically, I want to show you just the last thing that is this one. Okay, this is something that we have implemented in our chatbot. And basically, what we are doing here is in our chatbot, in some moment of our chatbot, of the workflow of our chatbot that Danny will show you now, we call for this stacking model classifier, and we request that the user has to give us an audio recording that it should be a cough, but maybe the user doesn't like cough. Okay, so first of all, we have to filter this. And what we do is just convert the audio to a WAF, predict it with the YAMNet convolutional neural network, then predict it with the support vector machine trained with the Pi audio library. And then of course, stack all the two predictions with the stacking classifier that I already told you. And if the prediction is higher than the optimal threshold, then this function returns a true. And if the function returns a true, it's likely that the audio is a cough. Okay, this is something that we have implemented, and now Danny will show you. So if you are good, Danny, maybe I could stop sharing my screen, and maybe you could start sharing yours.
Okay,
perfect.
Vale. So, okay, as Guillaume was saying, since we have still a bit of time left, I wanted to show you the actual bot that is fully operative. As I said before, the information that we need can all be acquired through a mobile phone. So with only something as simple as a Telegram bot, is the only thing we need to get all the data needed for this project and our project. So just real quick, I want to show you how it works. Okay. You can use it from the mobile phone or the computer. So you see here the menu, and you can add your data, your own data, and data for people you are responsible of. For example, if you are a mother in a family, you can add your children data. So you can add more than one entry. And of course, you can delete it because you are the owner of the data, and you can get rid of it inside of our database whenever you want. So let's do a test, okay? I choose a name just to differentiate the different entries that one person puts in. My age, and this all metadata that that you will have in your in your project, the one that we give to you. And here it asks us for an audio sample of cough, and here we'll put into test our model, the one that Guillem just showed you. Okay, let's see. My microphone is really, it's a really bad one, so don't laugh if it doesn't work, but all right. I didn't cough. And I will try to cough now. All right. Okay. it didn't work because I don't know. But on the micro of the mobile phone, it gets like 95% of the time it accepts it. So after that, all the data is stored in a JSON file and gets uploaded into our database. And that data, we will use it in the future to make a model like you will try to do today, but you know, a more powerful one. Just wanted to show you that it has a real application, and that what you're doing is actually useful out there. So just wanted to say that, as I said before, think outside the box. We have shared with you a lot of information and tools, but you can use whatever you want, all the data, and you can get your hand off on the internet. And I don't know, if you have any questions, we'll be here. Okay, let me try one last time. Oh, man, no, it worked.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, boom. I got humiliated already. And there are some symptoms here. Just put whatever. And okay, it's already on the database. And if I go to the data, it should be here. Danny is the one that I put, and I can delete it. This is still in work, so the messages are still not the proper ones, but it works completely. Okay. So that's it from my side.
Okay, perfect. Say that we will be during all the weekend as a mentors of our challenge. So if you have any questions, or maybe if you want some help, we will be there for you. And hopefully, maybe all the things that we showed you, maybe it could help you. You can use it, or you can just take another approach, because in fact, some of the things, most important things that we are evaluating with the challenge is the originality. So feel free to work whatever you want. And if you have any questions regarding the chatbot or the scripts, you can ask now if you want. I don't know if
don't look into the chat.
Yeah, Carona says the Bayesian approach seems to be the best one. Yeah, I think so. Also, that in a lot of cases the Bayesian approach, it's like really good, and it follows the intuition of the humans. That if something is working, just focus more on what is working. So yeah, I'm honest. I'm always like with you with the Bayesian approach. I mean, in fact, it's like a little bit like you have to have like more knowledge, like prior knowledge, but then sometimes it leads to like better tuning hyperparameters and also to better understanding of what you are doing. So yeah, I strongly recommend you to use whatever you want, and also the Bayesian approach is a really good one. Yeah. Let's see if there are like more questions. Kakarona say, but dude, that shouldn't be stored in some kind of service like Amazon S3. That's a really good question, and in fact, we thought about this. What we are in fact doing is that at the beginning, I mean, we are all this chatbot and all the database is stored in a server of the UPC in the EdShape faculty in the campus suite. And we are like remotely accessing and connecting to this server by an SSH tunnel. and at the beginning, we store all the audios of the chatbot in our laptop, which is the worst practice that you can do. But now what we are doing is we are like downloading the data in the server of the UPC then converting to binary data and storing it in the MongoDB database. Basically, because the audio is like really short, and the size of the audio is like really small, so it's quite useful to do it in this way. And then we delete the original WAP file in the server, so everything is in a binary data in the database itself. And then you can easily restore it as a WAP. And that's the workflow, yeah. Kakarona say, what? Wait a minute. Is that Windows? Yeah, man. I'm using Windows. Shame on me. Yeah. I know that I have to change to Ubuntu. I know. I don't know if you have seen some questions that you want to answer, Danny. Hamza saying, I can participate in the challenge, but I've learned a lot about Python and the libs. Good job, guys. Thank you, man. Thank you. Thank you. We have been working in this project since the beginning of October. No, I think, Danny, since the beginning of October.
Yeah, more or less.
Yeah, and I mean, we are like you guys. I mean, we are students and we are like learning by doing this a lot. And hopefully we have helped you just a little bit, hopefully. And if done, excuse me, if we have like boring you. A ver. I don't know if there is something more. Danny is falling asleep. This is not a question.
Yeah, we are past our time. We can finish here. If they have more questions, we can go to the Discord and we will happily answer them.
Yeah, perfect. So, well, see you guys. See you during the weekend. Okay. Good luck with the challenge. If you have, again, any questions regarding the structure of the data or something, just please let us know.
Yeah, and just remember to be creative and do whatever you want in order to get the different objective.
Yeah.